You step in and you are the minority. You are a black pastor, and all of the you have all the nations of Europe represented in your congregation, and it is the largest church in Europe.
Yeah.
And it began with a dream that God put with seven people.
Yeah.
How did you said you planted churches? Did you just start having services in a room somewhere? How did you do that?
Well, when God impressed, I was working on television, so I made announcements that anybody who wants to study the Bible could come. So seven people showed up. Then people were not coming any longer. So I was praying and said, God, you told me to do this. Why are people not coming? You said it was going to be a mega church. Then
you ran the seven off after the first
No. I was meeting with them three times a week, and I was hoping that it would grow. But, you know, because of my color, if you know Russia,
it's
very white, you know, white culture, you know. And, you know, for a black man to teach them is regarded as an insult. So people will not come. So as I was praying one night, God said, the reason is that you are expecting normal and regular people to come. He said, if you could go, he showed me a passage from Mark 12, chapter 37. He said, go to the down and out, go to the alcoholics, go to the drug addicts. If I could trust you with them, if you could go and just love them and release my power upon them to set them free, like I would do, just forget about people coming to your church. Forget about building a big church. Just go and love them and release them for me. If I could trust you with them, then in time to come, I'm going to trust you with elite of the society. I'm going to bring millionaires to your church. I'm going to bring politicians to your church. Right now, 9 years later, we don't just have alcoholics and down and out people.
Right.
We have businessmen coming to the church.
Right.
We have some of the top business tycoons in our church. We have members of parliament, the senators as members of our church. We have the elite professors. I mean, we have in a time in Russia when people don't go to church any longer, we don't know what to do with people. Because God trusted. He said, if I could trust you,
you have an annual conference and you feel the Colosseum.
Yes.
I mean, it's just...
We do that every month.
Every month now.
Because we have 30 services in the city of Kyiv every Sunday. So because our auditorium, the sports hall we use, is only sitting about 5,000 to 7,000 people. So we have other 27 or 30 other churches parallel. So once a month, I got all of them together. They come to listen to me.
It's amazing. It just says that if God tells you he's going to do something,
he's going to do it.
As a little boy in Nigeria.
Yeah. I mean, our congregation is about 10 times bigger than the village where I grew up. I was born in a village called Idomila in, you know, Ogun State, Nigeria, very close to Ijebode. And, you know, it's just a village of 200 people with 42 houses. I counted it. And our church, our congregation is several times overwhelmingly bigger than the village where I come from. And now, but that's not the bottom line. The bottom line is God has given me the burden, and he has shown me how to do it, to subdue nations to the Lord.
Oh.
And the problem is that we go to nations to build churches. That is our mistake. We were never called, but Jesus said, I'm going to build my church. Don't worry about church. Go and proclaim the superiority of my kingdom over the kingdom of this world. That is the basic assignment. And when God said, you go and preach the gospel of the kingdom, he didn't say, go and preach the gospel. That is what we have done.
Right.
We have gone just to preach the gospel anyhow. He said, no, go and preach this gospel of the kingdom. The gospel, the word gospel in Greek means good news. So that is not what Jesus was underlining.
Mm-hmm.
He was underlining the message itself. The message was not the gospel. It is the adjective qualifying the message. The message is the kingdom. Go and preach the dominion and the authority, the superiority of the kingdom where God reigns. Over the kingdom where Satan rules on earth.
Yes.
And go and show them light. And so when I come into nations, I began to go to the Netherlands 3 years ago, and in 3 years we have about 50 churches that are connected to us. And Amsterdam is a rough, bad place. They said nothing will grow. Right now, every Sunday, we have a church that meets 2 times, 700 people each time. Over 1,000 people in Amsterdam. We've planted a church in the Arab world. I sent a woman there to be a pastor, and we planted the church, and the church is growing about 300 people in the Arab Emirates.
It's amazing.
We planted churches in the last 2 years.
Are you going to come to America and help us?
In the last 2 years.
Wow,
in the last 2 years,
amazing.
We've planted 5 churches in America, and one of them, the one we planted in Sacramento, the pastor is right here in the audience. In the first year, he was running 400 people, and he bought a building for about 500 people in the first year.
Right.
And everybody in Sacramento is just...
Praise
and,
God.
You know, we are coming. I didn't travel for 7 years. I was not going out of Ukraine. I just wanted to subdue the nation. The assignment is to enforce, is not to persuade nations.
Uh-huh.
Is to enforce God upon nations. God is able. He is God.
Yes.
So if
Come
he
on.
Is God,
yes.
And we know him, and that is why I wanted to really share up the message about, there is a message that God put on my heart. Because the problem we have these days, when you read Psalm 24,
right.
And the sixth verse there, it said, this is Jacob, the generation of those who seek him,
yes.
Those who seek your face. Jacob, he said, this is Jacob. Where is Jacob? He's dead. No, this is Jacob. God is looking, God is having Jacob's, and he wants to raise up the generation of Jacob everywhere at any time. Who is Jacob? Is the generation of he who seek the Lord. And why Jacob? Why not Abraham? Why not Isaac? Why not Samuel?
Mm-hmm.
Because Jacob fought, he met with God and fought with him, he wrestled with God in Genesis chapter 32,
right.
And he never gave up. He held on to God until God blessed him. Mm. And the result of that is, God said, because you will not give up. He said, the generation of those who seek his face,
right.
Not just his blessing. Some people just want to build a good church and be
right.
successful.
Right.
If you are about success, you just want to be successful and popular, then forget about it. That is good for you. But we are talking about subduing nations.
Good.
And the key to doing that is to get unto God and say, until this nation bows to you, I don't want to leave you. I am holding on to you.
Yes.
No matter the obstacle. God doesn't have obstacles. The obstacles is with us. Are we really desperate enough to hold on to God and say, God, I want your face. If you show up in this nation will bow. And listen to what happened. When Jacob held on to God like that, God changed his name. He was a singular person, Jacob.
Right.
And God changed his name to Israel. That is the prince of God, the nation of God. He became a nation.
That's
listen
powerful.
Listen
yes.
closely. The generation of Jacob are people who will hold on to God until God makes them into from a singular person and transforms them into fathers of nations. The
wow.
key to be fathers, to subdue nations, is to seek the face of God, but to be focused.
Mm.
Hold on to God and say, and God will say, from Jesse, I will make you Israel.
Mm.
Everybody has the potential to become a father of nations. That is why Jacob became the father of the 12 patriarchs, because he could hold on to God. Not the promise was given to Abraham, but it was not fulfilled in the days of Abraham. It was given. Even in the days of Isaac, it never
right.
came to pass. But when you seek God, God will do some things with you. The first thing God did with Jacob when he sought him was he put his hand in the hip of Jacob and dislocated his joints.
Right.
The reason why God did that was God wanted to make him a broken man. Many of us, we are good already. We are too good for God.
Yes.
And that's why we cannot really get God's resolve.
Yes.
So God, dislocated his joint, because when a man is limping, he's no longer as confident. He's having just one leg to rely on.
Right.
And the other leg is relying on God.
Right.
God wants us all to be like that.
Right.
To say, God, I cannot do it. I need you to do it, to rely on his grace. The second thing God did for him is that God knew that he was a crook. Jacob was a crook. That's the meaning of his name. He was a deceiver and a liar. And God said, if you, any man that will hold on to God and say, I want just to see your face, you, as you behold his face, you are transformed to his image.
Yeah.
And that's the key. The thing that Christianity is supposed to be about, it's not about making it, building a big church. It's good. I have a big church. I mean, I have a healing ministry. But the gospel of the kingdom is different from the gospel of salvation. The gospel of salvation, which we focus on, is getting blessed. We just want to find out how to make more money. We want to find out how to keep a good family, how to live in earth. But what about what God is concerned about, making the nations of the earth see his glory? The Adam lost his glory in Eden, in the Garden of Eden,
right.
And God said, restore the earth for me. God is sending us to restore the earth and to replenish the earth with his glory. I mean, all the other things will follow. I mean, the miraculous will follow. I mean, blessings will follow. Everything will add. But if you want to use your faith to get a new car, I want to use my faith to save another nation.
Praise the Lord. Praise God. Well, you are a nation shaker, Pastor Sunday. You are a nation shaker, and we're just amazed. People are watching right now, and many of them have a call on their life, and they feel frustrated. They say, God, here I am, and I know you've called me, and I know you've told me to do something for you. And I seem like I'm a million miles from it. When you were in Nigeria or in Russia in the wilderness you talked about, and I know that God had nations in you that he would use you mightily to touch. Do you remember those days when the tempter came and tried to get you to give up on that dream that God had put in you to touch nations?
Oh, yes, you are right.
What would you say to those people today?
You know, I never believed that God could use me. I thought God could use anybody, but not me. God was so bad in the world. I didn't, you know, glorify God with my life. And I never believed it. But I got desperate because I said, God, I mean, you created me for something. I'm going to get a hold of you. And anything you want me to do, I'm going to do it. If you want me to fast for 40 days, I'm going to fast for 40 days. If you want me to pray all night, I'm going to pray all night. Just reveal yourself to me. And for 3 days, God appeared to me. 3 consecutive days. He was unveiling everything I'm doing today to me. 3 days I met with Jesus. And he is a real God. Let me tell you.
Yeah.
He is real and genuine. Get a hold of him.
Yes.
Get a hold of Jesus.
Praise God.
And he will give you your destiny. Pastor, there is a lady looking at me right now.
Yes.
You have the cancer of the breast. There is someone. You have the cancer of the breast. I mean, the left breast.
Yes.
And some other people could be there with the cancer. God wants to heal you right now. There is another person that when Pastor Kayanja was giving a testimony about his daughter, and by the way, my daughter was healed of the brain tumor also. There is somebody who began to watch this program. You can call on them and they have a brain tumor and God wants to heal that person. There is another person. You are totally deaf in your left in your left ear, and another person, you are 75% deaf in your right ear. If you would just place your hands on yourself and believe God, I mean, the man of Galilee, he is there with you.
Jesus.
And he's going to touch you. Maybe we could pray.
Amen. Father, we just release your mighty name that brings healing, the name of Jesus of Nazareth. May that healing power flow as he has proclaimed it. May every person who is hearing his voice right now receive their miracle in Jesus' mighty name.
Yes.
And Pastor, thank you so much for coming. We appreciate your ministry. You're doing great things for God, and we just receive tonight everything that you've said. How many of you watching right now in the studio, you want to be somebody who can touch nations for the glory of God? There's nothing wrong with having a big dream. There's nothing wrong with believing that God could use even you to do things beyond anything you ever imagined you could do. And Pastor Sunday has a book for pastors, you and your pastor. And you need to get this book. It's fantastic. I'm taking a copy home with me. And he also has other books that will bless your life. And if you want to know more about his ministry, I'm sure you've got all kinds of information that you can send them. I'm telling you, this man is a world shaker. And we appreciate you so much. Coming to sing right now.
Hey, that's another one.